You may talk of your pleasure trips on the Great Lake, but a trip on these snail boats, you bet, takes the cake. These steak is tough as a fighting dog's neck, and the flies, they play tag with the cook on the deck. The potatoes, she'll burn, let the coffee boil o'er. The fume nearly choke you, so greasy the floor. The cook room's a limit, you must eat or die, and when it's all over, you laugh till you cry. So haul in the tow line and take up the slack. Take a reef in your short tail and straighten your back. Whatever you do, be sure don't forget. Tap the muse gently while the cook is on deck. Oh, those were gay times and no equal have they. Whatever the weather, we'd run night or day. If I owned the world, on the ditch I would run, for no other place has such oceans of fun. She's so fond of biscuits, she makes them like rocks, and woe unto you if you fall in the locks. They do for a cannon, with them we kill snakes. You're not long on board until every tooth aches. Her pies are like leather, you need teeth of steel. Whenever you eat them, how strangely you feel. Her soups are the limit, though, yes, all her chow. We put it away, but I won't tell you how.
Delaware and Raritan Canal has cut through the center of New Jersey for 140 years. Construction of the canal began in late 1830. Digging was started at Trenton and also at Kingston. The canal was to run from Bordentown to New Brunswick, a distance of 44 miles. Besides the main canal, which was to open into the Delaware River at Bordentown, a 21-mile feeder canal was dug from Bull's Island to Trenton, its purpose being to draw water from the Delaware River to feed the flow and depth of the canal. The canal and feeder were dug with pick and shovel. Irish immigrants flocking to America during the potato famine were hired for digging. Their pay was 75 cents a day, paid partially in whiskey. Housing and food were bad, and sanitary facilities non-existent. During the summer of 1832, an epidemic of Asiatic cholera tore through the workers, killing them by the hundreds. Workmen who died in the epidemic are buried in Griggstown, Bull's Island, and 10 Mile Run Cemetery. Some graves were marked with names or nicknames or an initial. Some not marked at all. Many, like soldiers killed in battle, were buried where they fell, in unmarked and forgotten graves in the meadows along the canal banks and along the towpath. Here, we follow the canal's present-day course, beginning near the state capitol building in Trenton, running under the Trenton Thruway for 6,000 feet, coming out at Mulberry Street, running under Whitehead Road, crossing under U.S. Highway 1. At Princeton, the canal runs in this concrete aqueduct over the waters of the Millstone River, then through the canal's Lock 8 in Kingston. During the canal's life, many renowned and unusual vessels sailed its waters in order to avoid the perils of the open sea around Barnegat Bay and Cape May. It was a substantial shortcut. The ocean route between New York and Philadelphia was 276 miles. By canal, only 108. Luxurious yachts traversed the calm canal on their way to and from destinations north and south. In August 1907, a flotilla of some 200 yachts passed through the Delaware and Raritan Canal. It was the New York Yacht Club headed for the Jamestown Exposition. Among the especially dazzling yachts to ply the canal were Pierre Lorillard's strikingly handsome Riva, William K. Vanderbilt's battleship gray yacht, Tarantula, and most dramatic of all, J.P. Morgan's legendary black-painted Corsair One. Washes past Lock 13, the deepest lock, with the oldest lock house on the canal, built before 1840. Then past the Johnson & Johnson Company itself, and continues parallel to the Raritan River. Then flows on past the Pennsylvania Railroad Bridge, called the High Bridge, the only one of the canal's 60 bridges built high enough to allow boats to pass under. The canal goes on past the former home of the Janeway's Wallpaper Company. By the way, one of the first wallpaper manufacturers in the United States, attracted to the canal, along with many others, such as the New Brunswick Foundry, by the convenience of shipping. The Albany Street Bridge was surrounded by the prosperity of the canal's outlet. Here were the moorings, loading docks, factories, and markets. It was along here that the Star Linseed Oil, White Lead, and Color Works Company built their factory in 1866. It burnt down in 1870, was rebuilt in 1871, reburnt in 1875, and then their 300 employees became rather discouraged by the fortunes of the paint business. And here now, we see the exit and emptying out of the canal into the salt water of the Raritan River at Lock 14 in New Brunswick. Here also are seen the pilings costing hundreds of thousands of dollars of unfinished Highway 18, which was to cover part of the canal, a project since abandoned. During the construction, when the canal was expected to carry passengers, a special boat was built in Hoboken, a rare and one-of-a-kind boat, a passenger boat, especially designed for the Delaware and Raritan Canal. She was 100 feet long and only 8 feet wide, with a prow like a knife edge, a craft designed to draw no more than 15 inches of water. She was called, in Romance of Egypt, the Ibis. Her 100-foot deck was covered with an awning, beneath which sat 60 armchairs, upholstered in plum, no less. Scorning the mules which drew the freight boats, the Ibis was drawn by immaculately curried horses. Instead of the 2-day journey imposed by the speed limit on the freight boats, the Ibis traversed the canal in 9.5 hours. The trouble was that 9.5 hours was still far too long when compared to railroad time. The hope of prosperous passenger traffic was based on the idea that scenic beauty and relaxation would take priority over speed. Hurry was an American trait in 1834, even as today. The railroad took the passengers, and the canal went on hauling coal. This is the Delaware River at Bordentown. Here is Lock 1, as it would have been seen by Joseph Bonaparte, who dwelt in lavish estate on the bluff overlooking this site. Bonaparte, brother of Napoleon, former king of Naples, former king of Spain, lived here in Bordentown for 23 years, from 1816 to 1839. So he saw the digging of the canal and the opening years of the traffic on it. In the foreground, sweeping off to the right, are the tracks of the Camden and Amboy Railroad. In 1901, one of America's most famous train wrecks took place about 3 miles up the tracks. This was the renowned wreck of the Nellie Bly, celebrated in story, poem, and song. By the way, the conductor had the unfortunate name of Sap, S-A-P-P. His name generated the song entitled Sap Forgot to Pull the Strap. One of the engines of the Camden and Amboy, the John Bull, was probably the first engine ever to be outfitted with a cow catcher. Regardless of this pioneering precaution, the Camden and Amboy had numerous smash-ups during its youth. The average canal boat carried approximately 100 tons of coal. The boat was drawn down the canal by a team of mules plopping along the towpath. The mule skinner either walked beside the team or rode the rear mule. He urged the mules along with swearing, singing, and a threatening overhead whistle and crack of his long leather whip, which he yielded with the relish and polish of a virtuoso. Legend has it that a skilled mule driver could whip flick a fly off a mule's ear without touching the mule. The mule skinner was the canal's troubadour. A major mule stable along the canal was that of Jim Buckaloo. And there was a raucous song customarily rendered by the mule skinner as he drove along entitled Old Jim Buckaloo, and cast aspersions upon the quality of Buckaloo's mules. Mules and mule drivers were changed three times during the two-day trip between Bordentown and New Brunswick. Traffic was often very heavy on the canal, and the stopover for the driver and mules was not very long. And then they were hitched up and on their way back again. The first tugboat used on the Delaware and Raritan Canal was the Robert F. Stockton. The Stockton blazed the way for the use of steam tugs on the canal. A mule team could only haul one canal boat at a time. The tugs could haul a trail of boats, roped in line to one another. The tugboats also themselves carried freight in the hold, on the deck, inside the deckhouse, everywhere. The tugs did not, however, replace the mules to the extent you might imagine. In the first place, mules were cheaper. Secondly, even with rock facing along the banks, the tugboats were deliberately limited to a speed of 4 to 5 miles per hour. The people who lived along the canal would line up an inviting array of cans and bottles on their fences. Skippers and deckhands cruising by would sling chunks of coal, providing many a householder with his winter supply of fuel. The crew of the canal boat was usually the skipper or captain who piloted the boat with the tiller, and a deckhand in the fore who snubbed the boat through the locks. The canal boat was a floating home for many families. On a typical canal boat, you might see the captain at the tiller, the deckhand in the prow, the captain's wife pinning up her wash on the deck, small children playing, tied to the cabin to keep them from falling overboard, a cat or a dog slouched on the deck with a coop of chickens, all this floating blithely down the canal atop its load of coal. As everywhere in that world of the six-day work week, Sunday was truly the day of rest. All work stopped, and fun was the order of the day. Barge and houseboat parties sailed the canal. Clam bakes, barbecues, picnics, music, all kinds of music. Music on the water, music on the banks, fishing in the canal, swimming in the locks, baseball. Here and there, a little brawling left over from Saturday night. Relaxing and dozing. For the canalers and those who lived along the canal banks, Sunday was an event, a day to both dress up and take it easy. For instance, look here. Great-grandfather, grandfather, father. Yes, Sunday was a true holiday, a different life. From the hard, long work of the other 6 days, Sunday was a step into serenity. A day sweetly set apart, a way of life that was then and is gone. All through the canal's history, the conch horn was used for signaling. The mark of a professional was his ability to blow a good blast on the conch. When heavy fog hung over the canal, blotting out everything beyond a few feet, the long stretch of the canal was filled with the sounding of the horns as the canalers warned their way through the blind darkness, through the damp, dim air, the clop of the mule hooves, the jingling of the mule bells, the wash of the water as the boats plowed along. Above it all, echoing up and down the canal and across the banks and fields, you heard the blast of tin fish horns or the multitude of conch horns mooing through the gloom. Thank you. The canal company maintained dredging crews who worked throughout the season, scooping up the accumulating silt from the bottom. There were also carpenter boats and scows for general repairs. These boats worked the canal, repairing towpaths, locks, company houses, bridges, mule barns, and cutting down bothersome trees. Here is the Rocky Hill baseball team, the local nine, 1908. This is Irv Robbins, whose grandfather was the bridge tender at Rocky Hill. Barney McCloskey, Irv's friend, is still renowned as the best baseball player the town ever had. Barney's father was proprietor of McCloskey's Bar, an establishment famed and warmly thought of among canal boatmen. This bar was located on the towpath side of the canal, across the bridge from the railroad depot. A similar stopover in Princeton Basin was Billy Lynch's Bottle House. The classiest bar along the canal's route was the Bound Brook Hotel Tavern. In the 1870s, the tavern bought and installed the equipment and fittings of the Waldorf Astoria Bar in New York City. During Prohibition, the tavern was raided by state troopers who chopped up the elaborate wooden bar. Nonetheless, except for the television, you can walk into the tavern today and see it much the same as in the 1870s. In April 1899, the canal had a spectacular voyager. A Spanish gunboat, the Alvarado, was captured in Cuba, steamed north through the canal, stopping to go on exhibit at various points. In December, the canal had another spectacular voyager, the submarine Holland, the first submarine ever to be accepted by the United States Navy. In 1915, during World War I, the Liberty Bell was sent to tour the country and excite patriotism. It traveled on a special flat car with flags waving at each corner, and which carried lights so that the bell could be seen at night. As today, there was fishing on the canal. Freshwater fish from the Delaware River could be caught the length of the canal to New Brunswick. In the final lock and canal outlet at New Brunswick, one could also catch saltwater fish, for instance, killies and herring, from the Raritan River. One sees in the variety of cargoes carried by the canal the bustling activity along its banks. Steamboat building, canal boat building, farming, stone quarrying, ironworking, numerous other forms of laboring. Occasionally, while the men were working in the factory, foundry, or field, an inquisitive photographer would happen by, and the men would stop work a minute and pose for a picture, elegantly. In 1871, the canal and its partner railroads, named all together the United Companies, were leased by the Pennsylvania Railroad. The Pensy wanted the United Companies' railway business and their right-of-way between Philadelphia and New York. The Pennsylvania Railroad had no desire to run a canal. They decided to strip it of its commerce. In December of 1932, the Pennsylvania Railroad closed the canal for the winter. It never reopened. From that day on, no boat has moved upon its waters save canoes and an occasional rowboat or raft. The canal boats and tugboats were sold off or left to rot at their moorings. nature reclaimed the land, overgrowing its banks and towpaths with trees and greenery, and people casually used the canal and its lands for swimming, fishing, canoeing, hiking, and camping. Only today is the canal finally being officially developed as a recreational area. In addition, the communities and industries along the banks of the canal buy more than 73 million gallons of its water each day. The Delaware and Raritan Canal is more valuable to New Jersey financially than it ever was in all of its days as a freight carrier, even in those years when it reached its peak as the most prosperous canal on the continent. Both the state and federal governments have declared the canal an historic site. The old canal buildings, the lock and bridge tenders' huts, the boatmen's homes, the forges and mule sheds are being salvaged and refurbished. The waters of the canal are being stocked with fish. The old bridge house at Blackwell's Mills is being converted into a museum of canal history and artifacts. And speaking of history, meet now two gentlemen who have known the canal in the past, Captain Bill Lynch of Bordentown and Wilbur Smith of Weston.
You're familiar with the analyzer?
Yes, sirree. We could hear this boat coming at night several miles away with this automatic control on the rudder, see?
Yeah.
And it was a very, we could say, there comes analyzer. Then pretty soon you hear him blow the whistle for the bridge to open. And she'd go on, glide by us into the distance. You could hear coming and going.
Yeah,
the analyzer. Then we have those chunkers that come along. You know, there's two boats put together.
Yeah,
call them chunkers?
Hinge boat.
Well, they used to tie up down there below our place, which was about, 700 feet from the bridge. These chunkers would tie up there and go over to the country store and get some food. And any mules that need shoeing, they take the mules over there because there's a blacksmith shop there, a place called Weston. And they would do their shopping, have the mules shod, and go back.
When the canal was open, we used to catch an awful lot of herring right near those boats because the water was turbulent. And I remember I'd get a peach basket with a piece of clothesline on it, put a stone in there to make it go down and just pull it up. Might have had three or four herring in there. Besides a safety pin, just put it down and keep pulling it up and down. They were so thick you'd catch them. My grandfather had three barges, cargo barges, and the house I live in presently, the original part of it was built from some of his barges. The original part of the house, which was two rooms down and two rooms up. Now, of course, since through the years, there's been more added to it. But the original part was built from my grandfather's boats, canal boats.
Isn't that wonderful? And you still?
I still live in the
still
house.
Still live in the house?
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
But the forward part, the original part, that was built from a big part of it, where the canal boats my father or grandfather owned.
Well, you ought to be proud of that, my friend.
There are, here and there, hidden in the weeds and overgrowth, skeletons of old canal boats, scows and tugboats. Some lie in the same spot where anchored when the canal closed in 1932. Others were dragged ashore onto the banks and left to molder in the wild-growing foliage along the canal. As if their ghosts still plied the canal waters, the names of the boats come sounding from the past, great names. The Trenton, the Arrow, the Harford, the Raritan, the Delaware, the John W. Garrett, the Josephine Thompson, the Vesper, the Relief, the Edna, the Napoleon, the Elba, the Anna Eliza, the Molly Bowles, the Robert F. Stockton, the Ibis, so many others. Names that are a litany of the vanished, a poem of the past, and gone. A trip down the D&R Canal is a trip through both the present and the past. A trip through wilderness beauty, clear and vital and of today, yet hazed and surrounded with the echoes of all the 140 years past. Industrial water, community water, waterway park, visioned and carved by men as a watery racetrack to progress, the canal has become a place of repose, a retreat for people from the pressures of the progress they have created. And in the water, passing endlessly between its banks, the canal is born again into a new existence. In its reincarnation from a river of transport to a lake of repose, the canal has become its own descendant. The Delaware and Raritan Canal, once the busiest and most valuable canal in the United States, born 1830, died 1932, is again alive.